my name is Jake Adelstein. I'm an investigative journalist, and I have been one in Japan for over 25 years. I will be turning 50 this year, which means that more than half my life has been spent as a journalist. Whether I'll spend the rest of my life as a journalist, I don't know. It probably looks that way. I am very happy to be here at Mola, which is my favorite bookstore in Bordeaux. And outside of Paris, Bordeaux may be my favorite place because it is the home of Marcia Lee, the publishers of my third book, the third book whose title I cannot pronounce in French without embarrassing myself, which in English would be translated as I Sold Myself for Bitcoins, was written for Marcia Lee. It is appearing in French before it's appearing anywhere else. And Marcia Lee is also in charge of selling it abroad and making lucrative profits in Italy and other places. There is only one mention of the Yakuza in this book. I know that I've written two books. One was about life as a police reporter, including stories of serial murderers, stories of Yakuza, stories of ATM robberies, and the craziness of Japan. Second book was not a gonzo journalist book, but more of a narrative about the history of the Yakuza told through the lives of several Yakuza. Except for a minor appearance in that book, I play no part in the narrative. With this book, I Sold My Soul for Bitcoins, is kind of a narrative journey, sort of like Tokyo Vice. I originally did not want to do that. And Cyril and Clements, the chief editors of Marcia Lee, were like, can you write it like Tokyo Vice? And I thought, you know, this is a story about a cryptocurrency, a Frenchman who got over his head running a cryptocurrency exchange in Tokyo, and the Japanese justice system. But I am just an observer. I am not involved. I am not part of this story. I cannot write it with an I. I have a co-writer. And then I realized as time went on, and I was talking to him, and yes, actually, many times I became involved in this story. Because at some time working on it as a journalist, you begin to feel that the people you're involved in your reporting on are not getting the fair treatment that they deserve. So this book is a book about Bitcoin. It's written for people who don't know anything about Bitcoin, which was like me when I first started. I mean, I wasn't interested in Bitcoin when this began. I had no idea what it was. But I did know that as a reporter in Tokyo, when $500 million worth of something is stolen, that's a big news story. And that is how I began. My interest in Bitcoin began with crime. And I realized that there was a time when Bitcoin was the currency of criminals. Technically, I think in the year 2016, there is a famous academic institute that said Bitcoin is no longer the coin of criminals. It has become a legitimate thing. But what really made Bitcoin successful was crime. And following those early, the flip side of Bitcoin, the dark side of Bitcoin, is what a lot of this book is about. So if you don't know anything about Bitcoin, you will find it interesting. If you're interested in Bitcoin, you'll find it interesting. If you like mysteries, you will find it interesting. If you like spy novels, you will also find it interesting because there's elements of that as well. There's also a sort of mini Greek tragic play in this book about an Eagle Scout who, under the lure of this cryptocurrency and the idiocy of libertarian philosophy, sorry to anyone who's a libertarian out there, that's just my personal opinion, does not represent the opinion of Marcia Lee. You're fine paying taxes. Just don't ask for public health services. Moving on. But there's a tale of a good-hearted former Eagle Scout libertarian who took a terrible turn. This book also has corrupt cops, lots of money being stolen there and there. And to some extent, it involves Russia. It involves the United States. It involves the United States investigative services. And the one chain that links all of this is the now defunct Mt. Gox, which was the world's largest Bitcoin exchange, created by a French geek named Marc Karpeles, who you can see in a documentary called Suck My Geek on the internet if you look for it, who through luck and good instincts and coding skills became arguably the most important man in the history of Bitcoin. You would not have Bitcoin today without Marc Karpeles, because he was the one who really made it possible for Bitcoin to be traded and exchanged. I don't know when you're going to see this video, but one of the centers of this book, and I'm not giving anything away in the plot, Mt. Gox, went bankrupt in 2014, February 28, 2014, 5 years ago, But because Mark Karpeles found 200,000 bitcoins that he had just forgotten to transfer to the new accounting system because the company wasn't run very well, that formerly bankrupt company is now worth $1.2 billion. And now everybody wants a chunk of this company that you thought died and disappeared 5 years ago with everyone losing their money. Eventually, everyone who lost their money in Mt. Gox is going to get that money back, which is kind of a happy ending to a sad story. But the unhappy ending to this story is going to come on March 15th, when Mark Karpeles, who has been blamed for the collapse of Mt. Gox and has been blamed for the theft, is going to be facing a verdict in Tokyo. And I have no idea what the judge is going to say. I do know this as someone who has reported a lot about Japan and spent 25 years reporting on crime, 2 years as a court reporter. If you are indicted in Japan, you have a 1% chance of winning. 99% of all people indicted are convicted. To sum it all up, I Sold My Soul for Bitcoins is a book that's primarily about one Frenchman who realized that Bitcoin was the future and set up a platform to make it work and became very wealthy and famous doing that, but along the way lost a lot of things and lost his way. And the title I Sold My Soul for Bitcoins refers to the fact that everybody who touches this cryptocurrency seems to come away corrupted and in trouble. I mean, I'm sure there are people who've made a lot of money on Bitcoin who go on to lead happy lives, but there's something about this coin, something mysterious, like some sort of dark, cursed pirate's loot, that everybody who comes across it ends up finding themselves on a morally sketchy road.